So what's the most important holiday that we're going to observe in the month of Av? And most of us will most likely say what we're doing today. Today is Tish'a BeAb. And I want to share with you a couple of thoughts that are going to convince you otherwise. And not just convincing you otherwise for the sake of convincing you, but more to learn a little bit more about today and to learn a lot more about what's going to happen in a week. So right now we're at the Nahamu Ami stage. What does Nahamu mean? Nahamu means soul. And I want to take the focus sort of a little bit away from Tish'a BeAb and focus on Tu Be'av. Tu Be'av is an amazing holiday. Many people have never heard of it. We don't really know what it's about, and we don't know what its connection is. And really, it's so integral that I'm hoping to not only change your mind today, but I'm going to make that connection, Ezra Hashem, between Tish'a BeAb and Tu Be'av. So we're going to start with a little Gemara. It's up here. I want to thank Irving Hannon and Dick Kuwek for putting it up. And I have the English. I don't know if you can see it so well, but they have some sheets that are going around. So let's first get the context. The context of what's going on with Tu Be'av. What is it? Where did it come from? So I'm reading a Mishnah in Masechet Ta'anit. Amar Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel said, Lo hayu yamin tovim Yisrael hamisha asar be'ab ukeyom kipurim. Let's just digest that sentence for a few moments. There were no holidays greater for the people of Israel than two holidays. How many holidays do we have? A ton. Yom Kippur and Tu Be'av. That's an amazing statement. For the rabbis to come and put anything in the same breath as Yom Kippur is amazing. And not only are there not, is there anything else connected to this holiday that's coming up? Tu Be'av. Why? Well, we're going to start with it and see what the Gemara, what the Mishnah says. Shebahen, and now what happened on these days? What happened on these, on Tu Be'av? We know what happens on Kippur, but what happened on Tu Be'av? Now this, according to most opinions, happens on both of these days. Don't get any ideas, when I start to read it, I'm not gonna, you'll see why. Shebahen menot Yerushalayim yotzot, b'klei laban, all the maidens of Bnei Israel came out and white garments. And what did they do? Shibulim. Rather, these garments were not, you know, the most expensive. They were borrowed garments. White garments that were borrowed. Why? Shelo lebayesh et mi she'en lo. Some of the girls, it was unfair. Now you gotta make sure this person has more money, this person has less money. So you know what? Everybody had to borrow their clothes. White clothing that was borrowed. Shelo lebeish b'she'en lo, and kol hakedim ta'onim t'vila, u'merot yushalayim yotzot v'cholot v'keramim, u'mah ha'yom rot. So what are they doing first? They used to come out of the vineyards. Now these women were trying to attract a mate. And it was for singles only. Not just any random party. But anybody who did not yet find the nasi were able to come. And now, what were they telling the people? What would they tell the guys, right? The girls, you gotta have a strategy, right? You're gonna go to a party, and you're gonna try to get a husband. You gotta have a strategy, you gotta plan something. You're gonna talk to somebody, okay, make sure he's there, make sure this guy's there, right? Is he gonna be there? No, okay, I'm not gonna go. What should I wear? What was the last party? I'm not so sure. Too many people there, right? But what happened? What's his strategy? say, okay, I'll tell you the strategy. The strategy is we're gonna have a line that we're gonna tell the boys. Again, I don't know if you're gonna say this line, but maybe at another place we'll say this line. Bahur, Sada Ainecha, Ure Ma Ta Borelecha, Al Ten Ainecha Bedoi, Ten Ainecha Babishbaha. He said, listen, raise up your eyes, guys, and don't necessarily look at how beautiful we are, but look at the family name. That's all the parents here are saying, yes, that's right. Look at the family name. And, you know, all the boys are like, really, Rabbi? Won't be out of class. But no. What is the point? The point is over here that there was a strategy. And this strategy focused not on the physical beauty of the person, but it focused on what the family stood for. And we've all been down this road. You know, say, look, if you try to give advice how a person should find the shidduch, what are you going to try to say? You got to look at the parents, you got to look at the brothers and sisters, you got to see if they have suffer. Everybody in this room knows what that word is, right? Most people, no? Okay, I'll tell you, right? And that is something amazing. And we're going to come back to it, just digest it for the time being. As it says, you see this every Friday night, don't look at just the beauty of the woman, look at her yirat shamayim, her fear of heaven. Also says this. Also, the final pasuk of Eshet Chayim, which is also Mishle. V'chein omeh, se'en ha'olei na'benot ziyon, v'melech shelomo, v'atara shi'itera lo emo, v'yom chaturato, v'yom simchat lebo. Very famous pasukim. These famous verses. And this is what the Mishnah is telling you. This was the strategy. The strategy was the girls were coming to the party armed with pesukim from Mishle. How many people go to a party with pesukim from Mishle? Right? Margie, you come with pesukim from Mishle? Right? So if you have these pesukim, Rabbi, this is supposed to be, we just learned the secret from Rabbi Tawil, how we're going to get married. I got it, white dress, and pesukim from Mishle at the next party. The Mishnah says something. And this is what made Tish'a B'Av such an amazing day. But we need to understand really what's the connection. Because I think that there's a layer that we haven't peeled off. It sounds like we understand what it's talking about. And we're very, some of us, we've never heard of this Mishnah. It's Mishnah, it's like, wow, Tish'a B'Av, Yom Kippur, I'm floored. But I think there's another huge piece that's missing, and that's going to be the connection from today, from Tish'a B'Av. How do we connect the 2 days, and is there something to connect? Okay. We have another piece of Gemara, and now the Gemara is going to now dissect. What we just read was the Mishnah. So we say, Amar Yishimon Megamliel, Lohi V'yamim Tovim Yisrael, Hamisha Asad V'Av V'yom HaKippurim. That's the quote from the Mishnah. Now the Gemara is going to analyze and say, okay, why? Bishmama Yom HaKippurim, Mishum Di'it Be'Selicha U'Mechila, Yom Shinitenu Bo Luchot HaHronot. He says, wait a second, I understand why Yom Kippur is such an amazing day. Everybody gets forgiven, and these were the days that I got set, the new Luchot. That was the whole entire purpose of our journeys in Mitzrayim. To finally get the Torah. Yom Kippur I got. You want to tell me that now there's a great party on Tu Be'av? Amazing. How's that different than Shavuot? How's that different than Sukkot? How's that different than Pesach? Even we can go to Rabbanan, Purim, Hanukkah. I can guarantee you, Tu Be'av, very long on everybody's list. So the Gemara is asking that question. So what's the answer? Tu Be'av, Mayhi. What's so great about Tu Be'av? Amar Yehuda Amar Shmuel, Yom Shehutru Shevatim Lavo Ze Baze. We're peeling the onion a little bit more, going back in time. We know that there were many different Shevatim. How many Shevatim? How many tribes were there? We said 12, we're going to divide Yosef, of the two, we have Ephraim and Menashe. When Bnei Israel first divided up the land, it used to be segregation. Right? That's what we were looking for. Right? That's what that was the quest. But when you looked around, what happened? Every Shevet stayed where? By themselves. If you were in Reuven, you couldn't marry someone in Shimon. You went Shimon, could have married, like I say, Levi, right? Could have married Issachar. You had to stay put. There was no mingling. And this pained Bnei Israel. It pained people. And therefore, when was this ban lifted? It was lifted on Tu Be'av. That's what made the day so amazing. Piece number two. Now, what's going on? Right now, I have a party with white clothes and the girls with this peen from a shleh. And now I have, putting our own salvation, our personal salvation of sins, and getting the luchot on the same level of now allowing Shevet Reuven to marry into Shimon. Does that seem equal? At first glance, it does not seem good. It seems like there's an imbalance. But I want to quote to you a little bit about why there is such a balance. And we're going to start sort of with a personal story. A woman recently got married in the community. And again, for this person, she got married around age 31, 32. Again, according to that community, wow, it's so old. She's on Social Security already. That's where she got married. How could it be? Poor parents. And she reached out to me in distress. And she said, Rabbi, my friends, this circle of friends that I've been going with has changed. Now I'm married, and I see the other side of the coin. And I was puzzled. I didn't really understand what she meant. But she said, no, now that I'm married, and I hear what my married friends say about other people who are single, who are trying to get married, I cringe. I can't be around them. And she explained herself. She said, each and every bad character trait, whether it's true or untrue, whether it's valid or not, is highlighted and said to people looking for a shidduch as it's fact. Not only fact, but it's as if you're eating unkosher if you date or touch or go near or think about dating this person. And very intense accusations thrown out about a person. Well, this guy, drug dealer. Maybe he did something. Does anybody know what a drug dealer is? That's somebody whose profession is finding product, getting it out on the street, selling it to people, making a living that way. And she was saying, every other person, that guy's a drug dealer. This person is a drug dealer, watch out. That guy, crackhead. How many of us, although I don't want anybody to raise their hand, would understand, right, what a crackhead or that addiction is, or have seen it up close, or understood what that means? So a person who's had a drink at a party, is that a crackhead? But anybody who it's happening to, that's what's happening at the card table. Someone floats a name, and the person's waiting to see, oh, anybody know anything? So I got crackhead, drug dealer, and the guys like you have really. All those three? Now it becomes what? It automatically becomes fact. Fact that a person can never shake. And everybody who heard it now goes back. Well, you know that person? Don't touch that person. It's, they have something, you know, it's deep rooted. Person never met the guy, doesn't know what he looks like if they bumped into each other. And yet, the label is so strong that now the person can't shake the reputation. Come back to our sources. What do you think it was like when the parents of somebody from Reuven had to discourage somebody from Shimon to date their daughter? What do you think was happening at that Shabbat table? What were they saying? This guy, Reuven, not for us. Mommy, you never even met him. It's not for us. I know his grandfather. I know those people. I know what they did. They killed Shechem. They all murdered. They're all murderers. Yeah, they're all murderers. Every single one of them. 70,000 plus people. They're all murderers. And the rabbis recognized that this barrier, what was it causing? It was causing the Jewish people to disintegrate. It was causing such a tension between the children and the older generations that they didn't know what to do. But it went deeper than that. It went to the level where the naysayers said, look, we're saying so much Lashon Hara and we're slandering ourselves such a harsh way that we're never going to be able to recover. And it starts where? With the shidduchim. At that holy moment when a person is ready to meet the nasi, you can either go left or go right, the azazel or the Hashem. And finally, on that day, the Menesha said, enough is enough. Everybody, put your weapons down. Put your swords down and say, look, all of us in Israel were brothers. We need to stop the Lashon Hara, stop the slander, and recognize that we're all one. That day is like which day? Kippur. That day is where we repent. No other day stands with those 2 days, Yom Kippur and Tu Be'av, because we were allowed to marry each other. We're going to shift this idea, not just for marriage. I'm going to go a little bit more with Lashon Hara, but you're going to see where I want to end up. If you pay attention to the keynote today in Source 3, there's Gemara and Sanhedrin. There are 5 chapters of Echa. And if you pay attention to when we were reading, right after we finished the keynote, many of the keynote have a structure of being in Aleph, Bet, Gimel, Dalet, and so on. form, the entire alphabet. They're borrowing that from Megillat Echa. And if you look to Megillat Echa, you'll see from chapters 1, 2, 3, right to yes, 3 times, etc. You'll see it goes in Aleph Bet form. It's just one problem. There are 2 letters that their orders are switched. Ayin and Peh. And the Gemara asks the question. He says, I don't understand. There's Shoreh, Yisrael, etc. Who's writing it? They didn't know the Aleph Bet. Aleph Bet, Yehuda, Sameh, Ayin, Peh. They flipped it. Gemara asks the question. So let's read it. It says, Echa bet etzai, pasu alai pihem, amar ava, amar mi yohanan, bishvil ma hikdim peh la'ayin. Why did peh come first? Honestly, we're going on order. You go samen, ayin, peh. Now I come and I open it in perek bet, and I go samen, peh, ayin. Is there a reason for the switch? You bet. Yishvil Meragelim. The reason why we switched it is because of the spies. She'amru b'fihem ma'she'lo ra'u b'enehem. They said, phonetically, if you sound out the letters, peh, it's your mouth, and ayin is your eye. The Meragelim, they fell into the trap, and they said, peh, they were makdim what they said before they actually looked. And this Rabotai, what the Gemara is trying to tell you, combining Meraglim and Echa together into our point. That the sin of Bnei Israel, the sin of the Meraglim was doing what? Saying. Or stamping. Judging. On that which they had not seen. Forget Shiduchim for a while. But how do you judge a person when you've never met them? How can you make a call and say, I'm never going to that rabbi's place? Did you ever hear him speak? No, but you heard from your friend that her father's very religious. Super. He's not going to the class anymore, so you can't come. That rabbi's already pasul. What'd you put first? The ayin or the peh? You put the peh first. That was the sin of who? Of the Meraglim. We're reading the Echa. They're trying to tell you. Don't do that. A person needs to understand that those snap judgments without any facts is what brings the downfall of the Jewish people. That's what makes us exile. That's what keeps the Beit HaMikdash from being built. And it goes a little deeper, Rabotai. So what does this have to do with connecting all the way back Tish'a BeAb and Tish'a BeAb? The problem is that on Tish'a BeAb, we do the same thing, but we do it to ourselves. It's easy to see it, as we said, half jokingly, but then it got serious about Shiduchim. We can touch upon it when it talks about Lashon Hara. And a little bit now, you can also see it talking about rabbi or a whole faction of Jews. Very serious. But where is it the most serious? It's the most serious when we talk about ourselves. There are 2 ways in which we put the pair before the ayin. We say things before we even see. And the first thing is judging our own potential. We oftentimes stop ourselves from reaching our own potential because we've convinced ourselves, bepeh, or we've heard somebody else convince me that it can't be done. Instead of doing what? Letting what come first? Let's see. Let me try. Let me not listen to words of discouragement before I give it a chance. And every year, we get caught up in this. Every single year, we say, you know what? Maybe I'll change. I'm going to try to do it. But we let our social structure, as well as the voice inside of our heads, already tell us that we can't do it before we even try. And that, I will tell you, is why just under a week after Tish'a BeAb, this magical day of Tu Be'av comes forth. We're celebrating life. I didn't bring the Gemara. But many rabbis tell us there are other things that happen on Tu Be'av. People stop dying in the Midbar on Tu Be'av. The next generation was ready to go into Eretz Yisrael. Why? Because they weren't jaded. And all of us, Rabbi, unfortunately, we are jaded. We take our previous experiences and we don't realize that each and every day, God has faith in us to change and to become better. That's what Tu Be'av is about. To try to say, you know what, bring me everybody. Everybody who doesn't have a mate. Let them come out. Let them have confidence. Don't let them stay home. Oh, you know what, nobody picked me for the last 2, 3, 10 years. Why should I come out? Because don't put the pen before the iron. So that's number one. Being our own worst enemy. And sometimes Tish'a B'Av gives that to us. We always thought, because of our sins, because of what we did, true. But is it impossible to break the cycle? Chas v'shalom. And the second piece. The second piece is it requires us to do something that's not in our nature, is that when we're encountered with the divine presence, whether it be for a fast day, or being with our friends in a very kadosh atmosphere, such as today, to take the step towards God. What are the Yamim Noraim about? And why are we talking about the Yamim Noraim? Because we gotta make the connection between Kippur and Tu Be'av. What's the character trait of Kippur? God comes to us. During the Aseret Yemei Teshuvah, when we say, HaMelech HaKadosh, HaMelech HaMishpat, Avinu Malkenu, what's happening? We're coronating HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but what does he tell us? He says, I'm closer. I'm closer today than I was yesterday. For these 10 days, I don't care where you've been, what you've done, no matter how far you are, I come to you. Tu Be'av is different. Tu Be'av is about us taking the step towards God. It's very different. Because sometimes we think that the Aseret Yemei Teshuvah is every single day. Hate the mercy bubble, it's not. That's on a special level. But what's the message that the rabbis are trying to tell us? In the same breath of Yom Kippur, of 10 days that culminate with Yom Kippur, when I come to you, you know what's just as powerful? When you take a step towards me. That's what Tu'be Av represents. It represents all of the single people saying, okay, let's try again. And come armed this time with what? Not just with Pisukim, but understanding that it's about Yirat Hashem. It's understanding that it's about how connected you are to HaKadosh Baruch. And that's what we need to look at. Let's go all the way back. Picture the four ladies talking at the card table. Do you know somebody for my daughter? Do you know someone for my son? I have a niece. What character traits are you looking for? If you're looking for something that's fleeting, then guess what? The other person feels that it's okay to exaggerate, to knock the person down a peg. We don't even know we're doing it. Hevel ha'balim ha'kol hevel, as we say in Kohelet, everything is steam, it's air, it's nothingness. But we know that nothingness can be what? Why does Shlomo HaMelech use the words in heaven? Because air takes the shape of the container that it's housing. If I had a balloon, unlimited proportions, you could fill it with air. So it's as big as you make it. So what do? We take every little blemish that a person has, and what do? We inflate it. We make it huge. You know why? Because we don't have anything ourselves. A person who does that is also themselves filled with that same heaven. That person has failed to take the step towards God. So he doesn't care if the other person doesn't take the step. And that's how he smashes the person. But when we unite together and we say, I'm going to do it differently. I'm going to look for the good in the person. I'm going to say, you know what? He's a good boy. And we're not saying if the person is in reality the drug dealer, the crackhead, of course. Tell the person. Pull them over to the side. Mitzvah, tachnit, there's a purpose. But are we all looking at each other to say, how can I lift my friend up? We're all looking and say, how can I shelter the person down? The rabbis are testing us. God is testing us. In 6 days from now, will you remember when you say Yishem? Are you going to remember that that's the connection between Tish'a BeAb and Tu'be Av? Why don't we have a temple? We don't have a temple now because we took our brother and we knocked him down a peg every chance we got. And Tu'be Av is about building the person up. And it's the most difficult thing to do. The final source is one of my favorites. It talks about a Masechet Sukkah. Rabbi Yehuda says, "La'atid lavo, mevi'o HaKadosh Baruch Hu liyetzer hara shochato mifnei hasadikim." God is going to take the yetzer hara and slaughter that yetzer hara in front of the sadikim, u'mifnei harishamim. He's going to take the yetzer hara and say, "Look, whether you conquered it in this world or not, here I'm going to put it in front of you, slaughter it." Whether you're a Sadiq or a Rasha, Sadiqim nidme lahem kehar gavoha. But what's it going to look like? Sometimes when you vanquish your enemy, you want to put it as a trophy. For the Sadiqim, it's going to look like Mount Everest. Largest mountain. L'Rasha'im nidme lahem kehut ha-se'ara. It's going to be like that, like a hair's breadth. Just like a hair. But what are they going to say? Both types of people are going to cry. The Sadiqim are going to cry. The Rasha'im are going to cry. Why? Because they're going to say, Sadiqim Bukhim El Omrim, the righteous are going to cry and say, Heach, Yachol Lechosh Har Gavah Kazeh. The righteous are going to say, how did I have the strength to climb this mountain? Rasha'im Bukhim, and the evil people are going to also cry and say, Ve'omrim, Heach, Lo Yachol Lechosh Et Chut HaSe'ara Hazeh. And then the evil people are going to be looking and saying, how did I not have the ability to conquer this little hair? That's all it was. It was a little hair. But it's the same people with the same Yetzer Hara. Totally different perspectives. Rabotai, what this Gemara is telling us is that the choice is ours. What elation are we going to have on Tu Be'av when a person comes and says, you know what, I learned the message of Tish'a Be'av. And you know what it's about? It's about building my friend up instead of smashing my friend down. That's something to really celebrate. When the women came out armed with Nisukim, what were they really saying? I know I have flaws. I may not be the prettiest, the skinniest, the richest. I may not be the smartest. But you know what? I take steps towards Hashem and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And I take those steps proudly. And if you want to take those steps with me, we might be a very good match. And that avatar works from your nasib to business dealings, to being a person who could learn Torah, or to hear Torah from a rabbi. We're different. But you know what? I'm willing to walk together with you. I'm willing to say, you know what? Forget all of those things. I may have heard. I may want to say. But what do I have to put first? The ayin. Let's see. Let's try. Let's talk. That's the message of Tish'a B'Av. Are we willing to try? It's easy to talk about it all day. It's easy to think you're going to take the next step. But until you do it, it's very complicated. May HaKadosh Baruch Hu bless us. Tzkuv Nechamat Zion. This should be our last Tish'a B'Av. And always put the ayin first